Ryan Rucco joins us, yes, broadcaster, Yankees, and the play-by-play for the Brooklyn Nets here on Big Board Sports. Coming up a busy weekend and wrapping up the Yankee season, and Ryan joins us here on Big Board Sports on 104.5 The Team, ESPN Radio. Ryan, good morning. Roger Weiland and Chris Honorato.
How's it going, guys? Good to be with you.
Thanks for coming on, Ryan. Really appreciate it. We were just wrapping up the Yankee season in the last hour and talking about the first decision that the Steinbrenners have to make here is, what's going on with the manager? I mean, is Joe Girardi coming back, or are they getting rid of him? And I would think they need to make that decision sooner than later. Let's start with that. What's your thoughts on Girardi and returning next season?
You know, I mean, I think Joe is a terrific manager, and I think he's done a fantastic job. And, you know, if it was up to me, I definitely would be bringing him back without question. I think, you know, one of the added values of having Joe Girardi is that he knows all of these young guys. You know, he has seen their development from the minor leagues because he's on top of more than just what's going on at the major league level. This is a guy who's incredibly organized and detailed and very much in tune to what's going on at every level of this organization. So when you're thinking about the development of some of these young players, who better to steward that than somebody who has seen them since they came into the organization at the minor league level? You know, he knows what a Gary Sanchez needs to do to get better. He knows what an Aaron Judge needs to do to get better, because those are going to be crucial pieces. As much as those guys have produced already, you know, that's a crucial piece, is for them to continue to get better and improve on what they're weak at. And I think Joe is probably the best person to guide them to that, just because he knows them so well. You know, it definitely feels like there's more up in the air this time than ever before when it comes to, you know, Joe's future. I don't know why that is. Maybe that's just the way we've sort of played it out in the media, or maybe there's something tangible and real to it. But if it was up to me, I'd definitely be bringing him back.
I would too, Ryan, and that's what I rack my brain about. I don't get why this is even a topic. I mean, what Joe Girardi has done, where they went this year, next year is really supposed to be the year that they're, you know, get to the World Series and win the darn thing. But I mean, Joe Girardi has done a great job. Why wouldn't the Steinbrenners and Hal Steinbrenner want him back for next season? And especially when you look at the body of work this year and what they did and how those young guys reacted to him.
Yeah, I think that the only reason you could see from afar would be if Joe has burnout and his family is, you know, ready for him to be home more or something along those lines. You know, then I guess I could see where, you know, it's such a commitment, guys, and it's such a pressure. And let's be honest, now it's going to be an even different kind of pressure for Joe moving forward, because now the Yankees are going to move back from sort of this lovable rebuilding group that's overachieving to a team that's expected to do big things for a long period of time now with the core that they have. So, you know, there's a chance that maybe he doesn't want that daily pressure. I don't know that. But that could be a reason. Or, you know, if the Yankees feel like he was good for a certain part of this journey, but now they need someone else for the final part, that could be a reason. I don't know that. But this is just me spitballing for reasons from afar, because I agree with you. I think on the surface, it looks like it makes too much sense for him to come back.
Check him out on Twitter, at Ryan Rucco. That's R-U-O-C-C-O. And you'll find it's the easiest place to find his podcast as well, with C.C. Sabathia, part of the Players Tribune. So, Ryan, maybe you'll break a little bit of news on the podcast this offseason, because everybody will want to know, for as well as C.C. Sabathia pitched this year, does he have another year left in him? Does he have another 2 years left in him? What would be your best guess today on C.C. Sabathia and whether or not he returns to the Yankees?
I mean, I would guess that he does. He's been clear on our podcast, actually, even in the playoff preview episode, we talked about it some. He's definitely pitching one more year. I don't know that he will commit to 2 years. I've gotten the feeling like he's going to try and play this year by year, see how he feels. He had some scares with the knee this season where he thought his career might be over. Thankfully, he wasn't only able to keep pitching, but keep pitching incredibly effectively after the scare he had with his knee in Toronto in the second half of the season. But he definitely is going to pitch one more year, without question. He's made it clear that for him, winning is the priority, and he wants to be back with the Yankees. And, you know, this isn't just what he's told me privately. This is something he has expressed publicly as well on our podcast, that, you know, he wants to be back. Winning's the priority. He's made a ton of money. You know, I think if he wanted to on the open market, the way he pitched, he probably could go get, you know, a two-year, you know, $26 million deal. Like, I think that would be out there for him somewhere. But I don't think that that's going to be the priority. I think if he can find a number that's fair to stay with the Yankees for 1 year, that would be his preference. And I think that it makes too much sense for the Yankees as well, not just because of the innings he gives guys and the effectiveness, but also because of the way he leads, not just the pitching staff, but the entire team. That's rare to have that kind of unifier. And you guys saw Joe Girardi get emotional after Game 7 when he was asked about CC Sabathia and saying he is as good as any player he's ever seen at bringing a clubhouse together. That is an incredibly rare trait, obviously for anybody, but especially for a pitcher. And Brian Cashman, that was one of the reasons he wanted to bring CC in back before 2009, because he knew he had that reputation and he felt like that would be one of the ancillary benefits of having him when it came to the Jeter A-Rod situation. And I think that it just makes too much sense to not bring him back for 1 year for this team, which is where CC wants to be.
We're talking with Ryan Rucco, yes, broadcaster, Yankees, and we will throw in a question on the 2-1 start by the Brooklyn Nets for sure.
But yeah.
Ryan, one more for me on the Yankees. What about Masahiro Tanaka? We know he can opt out. He had a phenomenal postseason. Do you think he will opt out?
I think he probably will, just because, you know, business-wise, I think that, you know, this is not insider information. This is just me looking at it. But I think that, you know, you look at the postseason he had and the way pitchers have gotten paid in recent days, and I think he probably knows there's another deal to be had out there. Now, one thing to consider, and Jack Curry brought this up, and I think it's a really good point, you know, when you are from another country and you find a situation in which you are very comfortable, mm-hmm, and you like everything about the organization and the atmosphere, and you've gotten familiar with the routine, it's not that easy to leave that. You know, I mean, it's never easy to leave that for anybody, but especially when you're an international player, because there's more of an adjustment, obviously. And Masahiro Tanaka loves the big stage. He loves competing. And I think he loves the idea of pitching in big games for this team for years to come. So I would bet that he wants to stay, but I could see him maybe using the opt-out almost the way that CeCe used it at the end of his third year with the Yankees, where maybe he can turn it into just another year with the Yankees. I think the Yankees will hold firmer than they have in the past. If Tanaka's going to try and look for a six-year, $140 million deal somewhere, I don't think the Yankees would budge on that. You know, I think they would probably have to bite their tongue and say goodbye. But I could see a situation, guys, where maybe Tanaka gets an added year or a year in an option year, and maybe the per annum doesn't increase, but just the overall value does, and it could kind of make sense for both sides.
Ryan, one more thing on the Yankees here before the Nets, and that is, this could become a really crowded situation in New York. You're talking about Todd Frazier being a free agent, but what he does for that clubhouse seems like a guy you'd want to keep. Where does he fit? Brett Gardner, Chase Headley going into the final years of their deal. It's already a crowded outfield. I would guess they want to get Clint Frazier more at bats than he saw towards the end of the season. How do you think some of those names, those three, I guess, specifically end up fitting or not?
It's interesting, right? Because all of those guys you mentioned have these palpable, intangible effects on the rest of the team. And Brian Cashman even pointed out at the end of the season how important it was to have that mix of youth and veterans. And he's right. It is. You know, you can't just have a clubhouse with only Aaron Judges and Gary Sanchez's, even though those guys work their tails off and someday, you know, won't need all the veteran guidance. I mean, if you talk to them about how much the older players mean to them, they play an integral role in the development of those young guys. And if you look at the question marks around this team, or the players who, you know, maybe could not be back, right, it would be Frazier. It would be CC. It would be Holiday. And because he's going into the last year of his deal at a crowded position for them, it would be Gardner. And those are really the four veteran leaders of this year. Now, Holiday, I don't think will be back just based on what happened the second half of the season and his lack of versatility moving forward. That's kind of a given. But Frazier was so beloved in that clubhouse. I mean, I'm telling you guys, when I would talk to anybody, he was one of the first two people they would bring up about being a unifying force and just such a positive influence. But if you're Todd Frazier, you also got to think about business, right? Because the Yankees aren't going to give Todd Frazier the five-year deal he may get somewhere else. If he wanted to come back on maybe like a one-year deal and play things out, could I see that as a possibility? Maybe, where he's sort of rotating third, first, DH, and manning positions until Glaber's ready. Brett Gardner, I would find it hard to believe the Yankees would move because he's the vocal leader from the player standpoint in that clubhouse, and he also performed at such a high level. So I would think that the Yankees would be more apt to try and move Jacoby Ellsbury and eat some portion of that money and keep Gardner because of Gardner's value in the clubhouse. But you're right. It's a tricky situation. I think you definitely want Gardner and CeCe back if you're the Yankees because of that standpoint. And I think that if there's a way to get creative with Frazier where he's willing to put off his long-term deal for one more season, then you would entertain that as well because of his versatility. But that one's going to be a little trickier just because the organization and Todd are in different places, obviously, with where they're at moving forward.
Well, I hope they figure out Frazier. He's a great clubhouse guy, good player, really good clubhouse guy, and I love that guy's energy, man. He's a down to earth dude.
Jersey
is.
Oh,
I love
no
him.
Doubt, man.
Love
no
him.
Doubt. And it's just, I mean, you guys saw how much fun he was having, and right. there was such a positive influence. So, yeah, I mean, I think there could be value to bring him back. It's probably just going to be a matter of, you know, is there a price and a year amount that makes sense for the Yankees pieces that are coming and for what Todd wants to do for him and his family moving forward.
Hey, Ryan, final stop. We had Sarah Kustak on here a couple of weeks ago. She's pumping up Brooklyn and said, hey, you know what? They may not be as bad as you think. And here we are a very, 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 very couple of games in, and they're 2-1. What can you tell us about the Brooklyn Nets here so far?
Well, this is what I'd say. You guys know, you know what it's like to be a part of or observe, you know, well-run organizations versus poorly run organizations, right? And usually the well-run organizations will manifest positive results, sometimes at, you know, different timetables, obviously. But since Sean Marks was brought in here, there has just been a completely different feel. There has been a faith in the path that they are paving, and there has been a real belief that eventually it will bear fruit. And I think that what we're seeing and what we will see this year is just another step on that path. Now, obviously, that doesn't mean I think the Nets are going to win 50 games. It doesn't mean I think they're definitely going to the playoffs. But what I do know is the Nets are only making decisions that make the most sense for them in the basketball long term now. And that means trying to build a sustainable contender, not a flash in the pan, you know, group of guys who are going to win 49 games and then self-destruct and just, you know, be at their athletic peak for 1 year. They're really trying to develop and build these players. And I think what we're seeing is individual growth from hungry guys who do have ability, whether it's a Spencer Dinwiddie or a Caris LeVert or, you know, a re-energized Amari Carroll, as well as, you know, D'Angelo Russell, who is a high-end talent, obviously number two pick a couple years ago, who has a chip on his shoulder and who has put in the work with an outstanding developmental team. All these things mean that you're going to get a group under a very good head coach. I totally believe in Kenny Atkinson. That's going to play hard every night, that wants to prove themselves individually as well as a unit, because the Nets have emphasized high character guys who believe in each other as they've tried to rebuild this culture. And in the NBA, you guys know this. If you have a cohesive group who has some ability and is going to play hard every single night, you're going to win some games. Just by playing that hard. So I think what you're going to see is this Nets team be a hard matchup every night for an opponent. And there are some teams that when they bring it, yeah, they're just going to beat the Nets because they are more talented. But for those teams that are kind of taking a night off mentally or physically, or for those teams that have, you know, similar talent, the Nets are going to be able to compete in those games. And I think because of it, you're going to see them take a significant leap in the win column from last year. But more importantly, I think you're going to see a nice jump with some of their individual players who you start to look at and say, hey, that guy can be a piece moving forward.
They're going to score some points, Raj. Yeah. They're going to score some points.
Well, if you're a Brooklyn Nets fan, you just liked everything that Ryan Rucco just said. I can tell you that. Ryan, great job as always. We enjoy your work. Thanks for coming on Big Board Sports here on ESPN in Albany.
Thanks for having me, guys. I'll do it anytime.